cities in Europe. Yet so it was many centuries ago, and still might it be today if it wasn't for a choice made by a lady. The fine harbor of Stavre welcomed ships from many countries, and the ships of Stavre visited many countries. So rich and proud became the merchants of the city that they fitted their doors with handles and hinges of gold. Among these merchants was a young widow, the richest of the rich, the proudest of the proud, and they called her the Lady of Stavre. She stopped at nothing to show that she was better than her fellow merchants. She filled her palace with the most costly goods that her ships brought from all over the world. However, her rivals always found a way to copy her. "I must find a way to show them once and for all that I am better than them," said the Lady of Stavre to herself. "Somehow, I must get a hold of the most precious thing in the world." One evening, the lady attended a grand ball in the palace of another merchant. There she met a young and handsome and rich sea captain whose ship just sailed into Stavre. He asked her for every dance. By the end of the evening, he kissed her hand and said, "My lady, I was told that you were the wealthiest woman in Stavre, but no one warned me but that you were also the most charming." From then on, the lady and the captain were seen everywhere together, her arm in his, and people talked, wondering and guessing what would become out of it. "She'll marry him," said one. "She'll send him away," said another. "She'll keep him gambling," said yet another. It wasn't long before the captain knelt in front of his lady and said, "My lady, would you honor me by becoming my wife?" "Gladly, my captain," said the lady, "but there is one condition. You must bring me the most precious thing in the world."
"The most precious thing in the world?
What is it? Where do I find it?" said the captain. "If I knew," said the lady, "I would have purchased it myself already. I need you to discover it and bring it to me."
"I will do so, my lady. But until I return, please accept this ring as a token of my love." And he put a ruby ring on her finger. The next day, he sailed away from Stavre in search of the most precious thing in the world. Months passed. Everybody in Stavre knew of the captain's quest. Wherever the lady went, she could hear people guessing what would the precious thing be. "A magnificent gown," said one. "A marvelous statue," said another. "A pearl as big as an egg," said yet another. The lady was delighted to have caused such a stir. "And how they would envy me," she thought to herself, "when my captain returns with his gift." At long last, the captain's ship was sighted entering the harbor. The people of Stavre streamed into the dock. When the lady appeared, dressed in her finest, the crowd made way. The captain's ship was just docking. "My lady," he called from the ship, "I found what you desired, the most precious thing in the world." "What is it, my captain?" called back the lady, barely holding in her excitement. "I visited many countries and I have seen many things, wonderful things, but none of them seemed so precious to me. And then finally, in the city of Danzig, I found it and I laughed at myself. I should have known it from the start." "But what is it?" said the lady impatiently. "It's wheat. My ship is filled with wheat."
"Wheat?"
The lady's face grew pale, and she could hear people murmuring behind her, as well as some laughter. "Did you say wheat?" "Yes, my lady," said the captain joyously. "What else can be more valuable, more precious than wheat? If we don't have our daily bread, what good are all the treasures in the world?" The lady was silent for a moment. "And that wheat belongs to me, and I can do whatever I want with it?" "Yes, my love, it's my wedding gift to you." "Then pour it into the harbor."
"What?"
Now the captain's face grew pale. "Pour it
into the harbor, every grain of it. She could hear the murmurs of the crowd, rising behind her, both with horror and approval. "But my lady," said the captain, "consider what you're saying. I have enough wheat to feed the whole city. If you don't have any use for it, give it to the poor and hungry. After all, one day, you may be in need too." "I?" shrieked the lady. "In need?" Huh. She plucked the ruby ring that the captain had given her and held it up. Then she said, "This ruby ring would return to my hand before I am ever in need." And with all her might, she plunged the ring far into the harbor. The captain watched how the ring hit the water and sank. Then he looked back at the lady standing in the dock, her face red with rage. He said not another word. He turned to his men and said, "Cast off." At the entrance of the harbor, he had his men pour all the wheat overboard and sailed away, never to return. The next day, the lady held a grand feast for the richest merchants of Stavoren. She spared no expense to show that she had still any reason for pride. A huge roast fish was served in front of her for carving, and as she was carving into it, she saw something glittering in the mouth of the fish. She pulled it out and held it up. The diners gasped. The lady's face went pale. It was the ruby ring. A few weeks later, the fishermen found that there was a sandbar underneath the water right at the entrance of the harbor, because the discarded wheat had sprouted and grown, and it was catching all the sand that was drifting freely in the water before that. Soon, the sandbar got so thick that the tall ships couldn't enter the harbor anymore. The harbor was ruined. With it went the fortunes of the city. Many of the merchants lost everything. Among them was the Lady of Stavoren. Mm-hmm. If you go to the small town of Stavoren today, there is still a sandbar, which is called Lady's Sand, a reminder how the Lady of Stavoren scorned the most precious thing in the world.